Gary Paffitt, and welcome to the Nourishing. I won here last year, so I really like this track and hope to try and repeat the victory this year.
And Gary, of course, driving for Mercedes-Benz, the only man that's won two rounds of the DTM so far this year. Well, the Nürburgring, located near the heart of the city of Nuremberg, a big lake close to the circuit, as you saw, and always a very big crowd here. And even more because this year, the Legends race on Saturday with some very big names indeed.
I'm here to help raise, I think, about 1 million euros for charity. I think it's a great event to do that, and we work very hard for our charity in England, which is UK Youth.
These motorsport heroes have collected a combined 15 world championships between them over the years. Good to have Jody Scheckter back in a car. But it was Alan Prost who went on to win the race. Or the series of races, actually, driving in all three of the marks in the DTM. And when it was all over, Alan Prost was the winner. In his pocket, a cheque for 500,000 euros.
First of all, it was a lot of fun. It was very good to meet again with all the teammates, all drivers, all world champion. Big success, you know, for these guys also. And in a fantastic weekend, you know, we all appreciate this event. Normally, when you do a charity thing, you know, you don't do very much. I think we have given a lot this weekend, and we also receive quite a lot, because it was very good for us to be there. It was nice to drive these cars.
And there are all the champions with their trophies, but now let's take a look at this Nürburgring track with Martin Tomczyk. Here we are entering the start, finish straight, past the pits to the right, full acceleration into sixth gear, concentrating hard, and down into the Grundig turn, braking very hard, 120 meters we break, down to first gear, and accelerating away. Traction has to be good here, into fourth gear, then down the gears into the Schloller S. But really, this circuit, says Martin Tomczyk, is all about the two hairpins. You actually have to get the braking right for those. And down into the far hairpin here, and then accelerating away, very close to the wall coming out of this one. And up into fifth gear. And that's a lap with Martin Tomczyk. So quite a simple circuit, as you see. Here is the top 10 shootout for pole position. And Bruno Spengler, the French-Canadian, certainly showing very well indeed in one of last year's car. Spengler pushing hard, raced in Formula 3 last year, came over from Canada to race originally in Formula Renault. Now you see the split times at the bottom, and Spengler looking very good indeed.
I mean, since the beginning of the weekend we are quite fast here, so I was expecting to be in the Super Bowl, but to be third, I mean, I'm really happy. It's great. The team has done a great job for the whole weekend, and it's just a great result. We deserve it.
Well, he thinks he deserves it. Here's Gary Paffitt, who won this race, as I said, last year on the Super Pole lap. And already has Tom Christensen's time to aim at. Christensen, and at the split, Paffitt almost level with Christensen, and can he beat Christensen's time to take the pole position? It's going to be very close indeed. No, just misses.
Qualifying, the car was great, and I was really confident, but the Super Pole, I made a little bit of a mistake in the first sector. The second sector was okay, and I had to push really hard at the end of the lap because I knew it was a little bit down. So, not too bad. Second, would much more have liked to have been on pole, obviously, but it's a good start for tomorrow. So,
and here is the lap which put Tom Christensen on his second successive pole in the DTM. The Great Dane with those seven Le Mans victories behind him. Christensen in the latest Audi, a few sparks flying out, of course, very low on fuel in this particular run. Very close to the barriers. Tom proving he still has the outright explosive speed. And there he takes the pole. Politely clapped by Ekstrom and Green. They like it there at Audi.
I think it was perfect for Audi and the Abt. We put it on pole position. The car was really good in qualifying. And I was third, but we knew that I was able, even on this short track, to put the lap time in on my first laps. And I knew we had a chance for maybe bettering the third, and which we did. I was a little conservative at braking at turn one. It's very critical to come out with the new tires, and I saw Ekstrom had some locking. So I was a little conservative. Through the corner, I thought too conservative, and then I really bided it through Schiller S and through Dutzenteig. I think there was not much room left to the barrier, but I didn't touch anything, and we had a pole, so brilliant for me and Audi.
And that is the super pole result with Christensen, Paffett, Spengler, Alesi, Ekstrom, Reuter, Upwell, Hakkinen, Fasler, Green, and Bernd Schneider in 10th place. Well, this is not Germany. This is the town of Dumfries, the home of Alan McNish. We're in the southwest of Scotland here. And there, Alan in full Scottish ceremonial gear, complete with the sporran and the tartan. Alan, of course, former Formula One driver with Toyota, there alongside Mika Salo. Did a lot of the early testing as Toyota entered Formula One, moved on to race for them, and then test for Renault before moving back to Audi, where he'd already had some great success. Here he is now, living in Monaco.
Certainly life in Monaco is very different to anywhere else I've ever been in the world, except maybe Las Vegas. You know, you've got more Ferraris per kilometre here than anywhere else in the world. Maybe only at Maranello have you got more. The cars that are driving around, the people are all dressed immaculately, everything is always to perfection. And it's like Hollywood a little bit.
And here he is, driving around Casino Square. But Alan isn't too much of a gambler, although he likes to look at the casino.
Famous casino. That's where people who win the race on the Sunday probably lose all their prize money on the Sunday night.
Well, Alan, of course, went off on his Formula One duties after winning the American Le Mans Series for Audi, but now he likes to be back with the team, and it's a team that he works with very strongly indeed.
When I first joined Audi in 2000, I got to know a lot of the people, and then when I returned after Formula One, it was just like going home. You open up the door, it's the same people. When you drive the cars, they're designed by the same people, they're worked on by the same people, so they've got a continuous line, and it's something that makes you feel very secure. And I do believe that's part of their success.
Yes, indeed, but Alan now very much a part of the DTM, and it's a series he is really enjoying.
It's really impressive. It's something that I did not expect. The fans in Lausitzring to have 80,000 there with horns and the grandstand, the emotion, the passion, it was superb.
So up close and personal there with Alan McNish. And now he prepares for 72 laps of this 2.3 kilometer bumpy city course here at the Nürburgring. A total distance of the race of 165.8 kilometers. And there the drivers being paraded, including former world champion Mika Hakkinen, and an absolutely bumper crowd here, a record for the DTM of 166,000 people. And the air horns will go, the flags will wave as the cars ready to line up on the grid. There is this unusual circuit, this unusual layout here, using some public roads. And it is Tom Christensen who starts on the pole, David Addison, with Gary Paffett alongside him.
And then on the second row of the grid, the very impressive Bruno Spengler just out qualifying Jean Alesi, the two Mercedes on row two of the grid. Row three, Matthias Ekstrom on the inside, the reigning champion. Manuel Reuter going well to line up sixth on the grid.
And then Mika Hakkinen and Marcel Fasler in the Opel. Jamie Green a little way back this time, and alongside him, fellow Mercedes driver Bernd Schneider.
Heinz Harald Frentzen is next in the Opel Vectra. Alan McNish lining up with him. Then Frank Stippler and Martin Tomczyk, one of the quick Audi drivers, not doing quite so well here. He's 14th on the grid.
Ronaldo Capello, Dindo as they call him, with Stefan Mucha, Christian Abt and Alexandros Margaritis, and then Pierre Kaffer and Laurent Aiello bringing up the rear. So, waiting for the start, the lights will go out, they go out, and Christensen slow away for a second race in a row.
Down towards the first corner though, very, very good start being made by Gary Paffett as they come down towards the hairpin. Is he going to be able to find a way through? Bruno Spengler's made a bad start as well. Very, very wide goes Paffett, and as they come out of the corner, it looks as though there's a bit of contact further back. There is Frentzen, McNish, Kaffer, they're all involved.
Well, we often have dramas here at the Grundig corner, but the rest of them are certainly going well, with Paffett leading from Alesi, Christensen, Hakkinen, Ekstrom and the rest of the field. And Alan McNish might have got caught up in that incident. He's down in 18th place.
As Hans-Harald Frentzen's car being pushed out of the way, he's had a really miserable time since he came into DTM. But Gary Paffett then is the man in the lead. Jean Alesi going after him. And then Tom Christensen in third. But already at the end of lap one, Andrew, Gary Paffett has got away by about four or five lengths, hasn't he?
They're looking very good indeed for Gary Paffett. Remember, he won here a year ago. He likes this unique circuit, this unusual layout as they go around the hairpin there for a second time. And it's Paffett who's already pulled out about five car lengths, little gaggles further down the field around that tight hairpin. And Jean Alesi second, the best of the Audis is Christensen, and the best of the Opels is Reuter in seventh place. And look at the way that Jamie Green has moved up through the field.
On board with Martin Tomczyk here, trying to gain ground. Tomczyk didn't qualify that well. Needs to do a bit of overtaking before the field gets strung out ahead of him. Traces of that lap one incident, that's the remains of the front of Alan McNish's car. Marshall's adding to their souvenir collection. Here's a replay. An Opel on the inside and four abreast was never going to work. And Heinz-Harald Frentzen, I think, came off worse, didn't he? Gets bundled around. And there was McNish and Pierre Kaffer involved in that as well.
Well, the boss of Opel, Volker Stajcek, doesn't think much of that. He leaves his chair to go onto the pit wall. Just see the way the cars bubble up and down on this uneven paving here.
The leading three, though, now breaking away. Paffett, Alesi, and then Tom Christensen. Fourth is Mika Hakkinen, but he's coming under pressure now because Mathias Ekström, having a look to try to get past him, to no avail. And that's Christensen going for second, and he goes through. Tom Christensen ahead of Jean Alesi, but terrific. Tom goes wide, and Jean comes back alongside him. The two of them overlapping as they head up towards the end of this second lap of the race. On the inside is Jean Alesi, nearest the pit wall there. Tom Christensen, a dead heat virtually between the two as they came across the line. Jean Alesi will have the better line for the next corner. Absolutely fantastic stuff. On the outside is Christensen. He's got the place, but he's going to go wide. And Jean Alesi takes second. He takes the place back, and that he really deserved.
Yeah, but TK's going to keep challenging Jean Alesi, and he goes for the inside now and very cleanly gets through there. Almost caught Jean Alesi napping.
Yeah, Jean had to back out of that. You can see him move across and try and close the door. Realised that Tom Christensen was coming through. And look what's happened behind them. Mika Hakkinen and Mathias Ekström have caught right up as well. Jean Alesi, having lost one place, he's going to have to work very hard indeed to keep the rest of them at bay.
Little short laps, David, just 50-second laps as they head into a zone where they will start thinking about making their first of two mandatory pit stops. But Paffett has already pulled out 2.3 seconds and all the rest very closely bunched.
Yeah, Gary Paffett helped, of course, by this battle behind him as Tom Christensen goes a bit wide again in the hairpin, but he's able to move across, take the line, and therefore keep Jean Alesi behind him. Christensen, having got the place, Andrew, can't pull away, seemingly. They're all queuing up behind him as well. Alesi in the silver Mercedes, the black car there, Mika Hakkinen's Mercedes, and somebody off there. It's one of the Audis.
That's Frank Stippler.
It is. And mercifully, he's avoided everybody.
That's the exit to the Scholler. Whoops. S.
Tell him again.
Let's see what happens. Oh, he just got nudged into it.
Yeah.
Whoa!
Very, very lucky that he didn't involve anybody else in that. The car, look, drifts back across the road.
Oh, yeah, Margaritis just missed him. Now, we can see it again. Yeah, Stefan Mucha just tagged the back of the Audi. And Stippler, the Porsche Carrera Cup champion, goes for a very wild ride indeed. Back at the front, though, it's Paffett, Christensen, Alesi and Mika Häkkinen. Mika has already won one of these races this year at Spa.
But he hasn't scored points since, amazingly, so he rather wants to get himself back on the scoreboard here if he can. Down in fourth place at the moment. To the black Mercedes there. Look, Jamie Green diving up on the inside. Oh. Bang! He hits Häkkinen! He's taken extra out as well.
Oh, goodness me.
What on earth was all that about? There's Ekstrom trying to rejoin. And Mika Häkkinen in the middle of the road. Jamie Green trying to recover as well. Absolutely extraordinary, Andrew. Here's a replay.
Yeah, we can see it again. And I think Jamie Green just saw that hole and went for it. And the hole wasn't there. We can hear now from Mika Häkkinen his view of the incident.
Looks like Ekstrom and Jamie Green, they had a overtaking situation, and Jamie was not able to stop the last corner, and he crashed back into my car, and my race was over. But very disappointing, but you know, next time.
You see it again. Yeah, Green much too fast.
It was never on, that was it?
No, we can hear from him now. Jamie.
Well, I went down the inside of Mattias Ekstrom and I locked the rear brakes a little bit on the bumps. And so on the mid-corner, I touched Mika Häkkinen's rear and he spun around and I spun around and I had some damage to the rear of my car as well. So it was over very quickly. So I'm really sorry for Mika that I finished his race and it was my mistake. So I'm ready to go home now.
Good lad holds his hand up to that one. Obviously, he's made very few mistakes in the DTM, but this has brought out the safety car so the track can be cleared. And a lot of people will use this to make their pit stops. Here they all come, David.
Yeah, better to do it now under the safety car, then you don't lose too much time. So ignore Jamie Green at the top of that because we know that that car isn't really going to go back out again. You can see the clock's ticking away. Let's see who makes a very quick stop. Probably not going to shuffle the order too much, I wouldn't have thought here. But Marcel Fassler, 17.1. Christian Abt, 17.1 seconds. Martin Tomczyk on his way out of the pits, an 18.6 second stop.
Very hectic indeed. And I think you see Alan McNish there running without any front bonnet. Yeah, won't do the aerodynamics too much good. Let's have a look at the start again.
That damage of McNish, a legacy of the first corner accident. Bruno Spengler it was, wasn't it, that got bogged down. Tom Christensen not that bad off the line and just trying to brave it out with Gary Paffett down to the first corner. Christensen on the outside, Paffett on the inside, both ran a little bit wide and that let Jean Alesi up into second place.
And then all the mayhem at the end. You notice one of the Opals completely missed the apex of the corner and drove across the grass.
Yes. Can understand why Volker Strijcek looked so Albert's mother when we saw him there. On board with Martin Tomczyk going down towards turn one, heading into the hairpin. Through the left-hander, back on the power. Tomczyk escapes, behind him all the fun and games. Green flag, Andrew, we're racing again.
Racing again, and Gary Paffett right onto it at the very beginning here. Some locking up behind him, but Paffett has the advantage at the restart. Already has pulled out three or four lengths over the rest of the field.
Although he's yet to make his first pit stop. In fact, all of the top five, that's why you've got Alan McNish so far up the order, have yet to make their pit stops. So Marcel Fassler is the best of those that have made a stop. Gary Paffett, the race leader in the Mercedes with the green mirrors, and he is trying to break away from the rest of them again.
Yeah, that's certainly very good for Fassler. There is the McNish car with a little bit of carbon fibre hanging off the front. Green flags waving everywhere. It certainly doesn't seem to be slowing McNish down. Here's another replay of that Jamie Green incident. As you heard him say, locked up the rears because of the bumps. A little bit of inexperience there.
Yeah, Jamie having moved from the Formula 3 Euro Series into DTM this year. First season of touring car racing of any description. And they're having an important lesson learnt, I'm afraid. That incident that takes him out, and of course fellow Mercedes driver Mika Häkkinen, and also delays Mattias Ekstrom. But Gary Paffett, no delay whatsoever. And there's somebody slowing. Is that Jean Alesi possibly? Yes, it is. Jean Alesi's Mercedes that was in second place has slowed down. It's down to fifth there. Jean Alesi has got problems here, Andrew Marriott.
David, I wonder if he just nudged the wall there. There was a puff of smoke I just saw in the picture.
Well, let's see. He's not going to come into the pits, I don't think. There's Norbert Haug looking on as Jean Alesi powers past the pits. And in slow motion here, Jean Alesi, well, no, the smoke out of the back even before he got up towards our camera. So that looked pretty ominous to me, I'm afraid.
It certainly does. And he'll be heading straight for the pits. Now, that's that looks like a big engine failure to me. And that's pretty unusual in the DTM. Mm,
yeah. So Jean Alesi into the garage, into retirement as well, sad to say, for the former Formula One driver, Laurent Aiello, here coming into the hairpin, going very, very wide, brakes far too late, and loses out there to Ben Schneider.
Yes, definitely missed his braking for that, and all the competitors are going to have to watch out for various bits of...
Oh, yes! That is quite a lot of car. Now, somebody's had a big, big lose there at the hairpin. And it's Capello. Look, that Dindo Capello coming towards us. The car's crabbing. It's obviously hit the barrier or hit somebody. And lots of Audis on the circuit. That's going to bring out the safety car again, I would have thought, so the marshals can move all of that. It's like a little slalom now as you get back onto the power out of the hairpin. Capello has had a big moment there, hasn't he?
Absolutely. So easy to cut your tyres on that bodywork that's lying there, the shards of carbon fibre. All the rear has gone, look. And the rivals get a good look at the rear transmission there.
Garage door will be down quickly once that parts. Here's the replay, loses the back of the car and crunch right into the wall. Huge sections of bodywork. So more pit stops to be taken. Gary Pappy just pitted, so is Christensen. Stefan Mücker coming in as well. So, race order, Gary Pappett leading Tom Christensen and Christian Abloch, who's made his two pit stops now up into third place. And that really is a good team and a good driver combination, if you like, using the two safety cars to their advantage there.
Yes, very good strategy indeed. But, of course, it also played in the hands of Gary Pappett. We see that big crunch. It lifted the back off the ground as it hit the unremitting wall there.
Honestly, I don't know what's happened. I just suddenly lost the car, the rear, and but... I was not faster compared to the lap before, I was not offline. It just came so suddenly that I really could not react. When I felt that suddenly the rear were gone, I was ready to crash hard.
Yeah, so Dindo Capello not at all happy. And we saw Marcel Fassler in the pits and looks as if he was going to go into retirement. Meanwhile, Gary Paffett makes a pit stop. David, it's all happening here.
Yeah, I'm a bit mystified about what's happened to Marcel Fassler, though, because it didn't look as though he'd had a problem, but the car came in with damage and looks as though, yeah, you can see it there. It's being pushed into the garage. So very strange, all of this. Marcel Fassler now a retirement from the race, and time for us to have a word and find out why.
Ich bin eigentlich in einem super Ausgangslage.
I came into the pits for my second stop with very good prospects, I have to say. Brakes as usual, just like the whole weekend, and then suddenly the front of my car just slid away. I suspect there must have been some oil from the Capello accident. I had no chance at all. I locked up my braking. I hit the crash barrier absolutely full speed and damaged my car very badly, so I couldn't go on. So that's the mystery solved, David. Appears that he went off on the Capello oil.
Now, Gary Paffett has made both his pit stops under that last safety car period. So one stop straight after the other, effectively. And now Gary trying to work his way past one or two of those theoretically slower cars. And here you can see right up alongside Mathias Ekström as they come then side by side across the line. Gary Paffett, Mathias Ekström, two star drivers in the DTM. And Gary Paffett in the Mercedes has got the line for the hairpin, and he should now, Andrew, gain the place.
Yes, indeed. He locked up the brakes, smoke coming off the rear tyres as he went in, but he made it work. And these two going into this race, separated by only 1 point at the top of the championship table. This is absolutely vital for both their title hopes. There's Margaritas going through in the orange car.
Margaritas last year in Formula 3 also drove in the FIA GT Championship towards the end of the season. Now he's about to be caught by his teammate, effectively, Mercedes driver, fellow Mercedes man, Gary Pafford. Is Margaritas going to fight him, or is the Greek driver going to let him by? Let's see, because up across the start and finish line now comes Margaritas. There is Gary Pafford. He moves to the inside, and Margaritas doesn't exactly make it difficult for Gary. The Mercedes team leader virtually these days goes through up into another place, into the hairpin, with Margaritas now stuck there between Gary Pafford and Mathias Ekström, and this is played right into Mercedes' hands now.
Yeah, Pafford's had a busy few weeks in between the two DTM races. As Ekström gives Margaritas a bit of a nudge. Gary was commentating at the British Grand Prix for Silverstone.
Race order, Tom Christensen yet to make a second stop, but Christian Abt is the best of those that have stopped twice. Gary Pafford going after him, and there's more fun and games there as Alexander Margaritas is passed by both Bert Schneider and also Bruno Spengler. So Margaritas, who was in a rather inflated position by dint of the safety cars and the pit stops, is now being pushed back down the order. But this, I think, Andrew, it's fair to say, is the best we've seen of Christian Abt for quite some time.
Yes, indeed it is, and of course no longer driving for his family team, but driving the 2004 car run by the rival Yost organisation, better known, of course, for all their successes at Le Mans. Margaritas and Aiello battling for 7th and 8th places. The young German-Greek driver giving good account of himself here.
Laurent Aiello up behind him. Aiello is somebody else that's had a really torrid time since joining Opel.
Yeah, former DTM champion with Audi, of course, and very successful in the past in the British Touring Car Championship. Another man who has a Le Mans victory on his resume or CV. Christensen and out to Pafford, 1.4 seconds. That's the real battle for the lead.
And it's a gap that's coming down, isn't it? There is Tom Christensen, who does lead the race, but he's having to give that up when he next comes into the pit lane. He's got to make the mandatory second stop, and as he does so, therefore, Christian Abt will take over the lead from Gary Pafford. On board with Laurent Aiello, that is Alex Margaritas along, ahead of him.
And that's one of the last year's Mercedes-Benz. Of course, for 2004, they switched to the four-door model. Previously, they ran two doors, and the tangle there, and Aiello turns Margaritas around. And I've no doubt we'll see that again. So Margaritas gets a little bit of a lesson from an old master.
I think some frustration, though, in Aiello's driving there with a car that's just not as competitive as he would like. And as they come into the corner, he comes for a long way back for my money there. He's not really alongside, is he? And just charges into the side of the Mercedes. And like you say, turns it round.
See it again. No, I think we have to point the finger there at Laurent Aiello. That wasn't really an opening. Let's see it from inside Aiello's car.
No, never alongside.
And nothing Margaritas could do about that. Quite a lot of oil flying about. You can see all that oil dry on the ground as well from the incidents down at that corner.
Mathias Ekström now under pressure look from Bert Schneider as they come up across the line. This is the fight for fourth and fifth. The Red Bull Audi ahead of the Mercedes there. Bert Schneider having a look as they come down to the hairpin. Tries the outside line. What he needs, though, is to tighten the line through the corner, get up on the inside, coming out of the hairpin. But Mathias Ekström knows what Schneider is up to and puts the car right in the way. And ahead of them, look, Christian Abt has got Gary Pafford right up behind him now. Fascinating duels here.
Yeah, and Gary will be really charging very hard now to close up on Christian Abt.
I just wonder how much quicker Schneider could go if he wasn't stuck there behind Mathias Ekström. Pafford up the inside of Abt, through he goes. Gary Pafford goes ahead. That's second on the road in real terms, though. He's the race leader because of Tom Christensen having to make that extra stop, or that second mandatory stop that Gary has already completed. So it's Pafford ahead of Abt, ahead of Ekström, ahead of Schneider as they all come pouring over the line now.
I'd like to see that incident again, David. I think he caught Abt napping a little bit there.
Ekström and Schneider nose to tail. Two real DTM masters here, aren't they?
Absolutely. Schneider, of course, won more DTM races than anybody else. Also, World Sports Car Championship. He's won for Mercedes-Benz in the past. Bernd Schneider now 40 one of the veterans of the DTM, but still very competitive. Here's this incident again of the overtaking of Gary Paffett. Put himself in exactly the right place, and he was left the space there by the Audi.
Yes, I think Ab realised that he wasn't going to be able to hold him off indefinitely, so there was no point doing anything that would risk either car. And a fair driver there, Christian Ab, giving Gary Paffett enough racing room. Here's the Ekstrom-Schneider battle. They touch, and Matthias Ekstrom goes a little bit wide, and Ben Schneider goes up the inside, but then Ekstrom has the tighter line. No, he doesn't. Ben Schneider just able to cut across. There was a little touch between the two, but Ben Schneider goes ahead. Laurent Aiello comes down the pit lane, and you're riding with him. He's about to rejoin. Here, though, is Schneider, then Ekstrom, accelerating their way up that short straight. And a replay here, Ben Schneider there just tags the back of Matthias Ekstrom's car. That possibly does enough to unsettle the Swede going into the hairpin, and Ben Schneider up the inside takes the face.
Yeah, just pulled off one of those aerodynamic aids at the back. And we had another Mercedes clash here, and Bruno Spengler's involved in that.
And so was Schneider. Schneider's recovered, but that's Bruno Spengler trying to rejoin right in front of the camera.
Yes, the French-Canadian did such a strong job in qualifying, but it appears he's dropped it here.
Well, we didn't see who did what to which and to whom, but either way, cars with damage. Schneider trying to recover, of course, now. This, though, is for the lead. Tom Christensen has got Gary Paffett right up behind him. Gary doesn't have to get past Christensen on the track because Tom has yet to pit, but Gary Paffett does not want to get stuck there behind Tom for too much longer. Here they come, almost overlapping as they head towards the line, but Christensen's going to stay out a little bit longer, and Gary Paffett, with clearly the quicker car here, Andrew, is right up behind him as they come across the line.
Absolutely, David. Tom certainly defending his line very strongly indeed. He doesn't want to let Gary Paffett get past. And after all, despite the fact that Tom has to make a pit stop, it is the battle for the lead. You never know, they might red flag the race right now.
Still got 13 more laps to run. Accelerating then up the straight towards us. It's Audi ahead of Mercedes. These two manufacturers that have dominated DTM in recent times. Opel, the third manufacturer, still struggling. And sadly, we know Opel in its last year in DTM. Gary Paffett locking up there, trying very hard as he comes into that very tight left-hander. And a replay here of the Spengler-Schneider accident. Bruno Spengler up the inside from too far back, just like the Jamie Green incident. Hits Schneider and turns him around.
I was behind Matthias Ekstrom, and it took Bernd Schneider about 10 laps to overtake him. Finally, he managed to overtake him. Then it was my turn to overtake him, and I did a small mistake. I braked a little bit too late in the last corner, and just came sideways, touched Matthias, and also touched a little bit Bernd. And yeah, I'm really sorry for him. It was a stupid mistake from me. Yeah, I'm really disappointed about it.
Yeah, there you see it again, and well, it was quite a big mistake, I thought, actually. He was out of control as he arrived into the corner.
But almost a carbon copy of what Jamie Green did. Here into the pits comes Tom Christensen, his second mandatory stop. And, of course, this hands the lead to Gary Paffett. Very quick stop, Andrew, 5 seconds.
And while all that's been going on, amazingly, the Alan McNish hot rod, without its bonnet, is making very good progress, strangely enough. Made some very good, well-called pit stops.
Gary Paffett ahead of Christian Abt. Now, the gap between the two of them, 11 tenths of a second. Let's just see. Christian Abt, I reckon, might be coming back a little bit here at Gary, who's worked that car very hard in the middle section of this race.
Yes, so Abt using the older model Audi, but most of the gains have been in the aerodynamic area, and there's not too much aerodynamics coming to play around this little short circuit here.
There's Alan McNish ahead of Ben Schneider. McNish having had the new bonnet put on at the first pit stop here, but Ben Schneider trying to recover after losing time early on in that incident with Spengler. Up the inside he goes, a little bit too quick, runs wide. Can McNish come back at him? Well, Ben Schneider makes the Mercedes just wide enough to get the Audi. Ben Schneider hits the wall. Has he done much damage? Alan McNish tries to get the run on the outside of him here. Ben Schneider making a little mistake there, up against the concrete. McNish on the inside, he's going to go through, I think. Yes! McNish goes back ahead in the Audi.
The little man from Dumfries really enjoys this DTM racing. He's having a very good run here as Laurent Aiello retires the Playboy car.
And there's Schneider bouncing off the concrete.
Let's see how hard he hit it. Quite hard. Yeah. Rocked the whole chassis.
Hard enough, isn't it? And look at the way that Munish has to just slide the car around in there to avoid making contact. 10 more laps to run. It's going to be fascinating now to see if Schneider starts to lose time and lose any further places. But Gary Paffett is leading. Christian Abt is second.
Riding on board with Martin Tomczyk then. And Tomczyk and Reuter there. And Reuter just slides past. Manuel Reuter, yet another man in this race with a Le Mans victory to his credit. And another of the real veterans in this series. Been an Opel driver for a very long time, Manuel Reuter.
Yes, he's been loyal to Opel. Opel loyal to Reuter as well, because the results haven't really been there in the last few seasons, but he did win the ITC for them a few years back. On board here with Martin Tomczyk. With only 9 more laps to run, pretty demanding circuit this. It may not be a very long lap, but you've got to maintain concentration all the way around with these unforgiving walls and barriers, and those straights very fast indeed. There, up the inside, look, goes Manuel Reuter, grabs the place of Tomczyk.
Well, there's plenty of action for the 160,000 plus fans to cheer on here at this unusual race circuit. There's Dr. Wolfgang Ulrich sitting on the pit wall.
Looking a bit concerned, I thought, there with Hans-Jürgen Abt.
Well, lots of Audis in the positions behind. Gary Paffett, the leader. But of course, a win here would certainly do. Oh, and Margaritas gets turned around.
By Ben Schneider, no less.
All the Mercedes other than Gary Paffett seem to be in the wars one way or another.
I'd love to be a fly on the wall in the boardroom on Monday morning when Herr Haug has a word with most of his drivers about their tactics this weekend. I don't think he'll be overly impressed. The damage bill greater than normal for Mercedes.
Yeah, I don't think Norbert's going to worry too much about that, to be honest.
Here's the replay. Schneider up the inside. One nudge, a second nudge, round goes Margaritas. I don't think it was deliberate on Bernd's part. He just went for a gap that rather closed on him. Margaritas there on the outside line. Bernd Schneider sees the gap on the inside. Margaritas comes across and tries to claim the line.
I wonder if Alan McNish looked in his mirror and saw all that going on.
Well, Gary Paffett is the race leader, and yet again, a superb drive. Gary, bear in mind, is the only man so far in DTM this year to have won twice, and it looks, Andrew, as though he's about to become the first person to win three times.
Yes, indeed, and Gary can just conserve the car and particularly the tyres a little bit now.
Just look at the left-hand side of Mathias Ekström's car. It's all a bit banana-shaped there, look.
Yeah, the mirror's hanging off, and there's scars down the side of it.
Well, there's still 6 more laps to run, and on the evidence that we've had so far, I don't think we're finished yet in terms of incidents.
Now, this has certainly been a full contact race, hasn't it?
That's Manuel Reuter running wide up against the barrier, losing his right-hand mirror. So the Opel there with a bit more damage, and Mathias Ekström's battered Audi there in the replay going through the corner. Number one, last year's champion, Gary Paffett, one of the few drivers to have had a comfortable race here. Abt is second. Mathias Ekström third, but being caught now by Manuel Reuter. This, I think it's fair to say, Reuter's best shape for quite some time.
Oh, absolutely, David. Having a very good run here indeed, and just fascinated with those early pictures showing just how bumpy this track is in certain places. Cars bobbing around, just under a second between Abt and Reuter, and Reuter moving in a little bit, and Tomczyk moving in on Reuter. So we can have something of a grandstand finish here. Alan McNish protecting his corner there from Bernd Schneider, who's right with him.
Two real star drivers here. McNish may be new to DTM, but of course he's raced at the highest level in Formula One, like Bernd Schneider, although Alan's time in Formula One much more recent than that of the German, driving for Toyota, and then as the test driver, the third driver for the Renault team.
The German, of course, driving for Zaxspeed all those years ago. Zaxspeed long out of Formula One. Jonathan Palmer, the British entrepreneur, owner of Brands Hatch, also an ex-Zaxspeed driver.
That's right, yes.
And there's that famous stadium
Schneider's chance into the hairpin. It's not, because Alan McNish knows exactly where to put the car, doesn't he? Out of the hairpin, back on the power. Very, very evenly matched, these two. But Gary Paffett, with only four more laps to run, has turned in a very impressive performance indeed. Dominated the second class of the British Formula 3 Championship back in 2000, then went on to race in the German Formula 3 Championship and switched to DTM only 2 years ago, really, as part of the shuffle at Mercedes created by Uwe Altsen, walking away from DTM at the 11th hour before the first round. Gary Paffett initially given a year-old car, but then last year he had impressed so much he was brought into the current spec of car, and that's probably one of the best moves the Mercedes management has made.
Agree with all that. But this has been a tremendous exhibition of great DTM racing here. Alan McNish just getting a helping hand from Bert Schneider.
Come on, Alan, go quicker. Oop. More bits of bodywork go flying. Norbert Haug watching on.
And there's the Audi control point. The command post.
Looking rather anxious here. Drive-through penalty for Bert Schneider for pushing another car. You can see the legend there on the screen. Bert Schneider to receive a drive-through penalty.
A little bit harsh, that, I think.
Yeah. It's bearing in mind one or two other tactics we've seen in the course of this. Manuel Reuter there looking for a way to get past Ekström, who goes wide. The two of them come out almost side by side. Matthias Ekström just ahead, Manuel Reuter alongside him. They almost lean on each other, but Matthias Ekström has the line for the next corner. And Ekström hangs onto the place there. Oh, and a spin in the background. Is that Tom Chick?
Yeah, absolutely sure it was, yes.
It is, yeah. Martin Tomczyk rejoining. I don't think he lost a place in all of that. Rejoins now. Two more laps to run. Andrew, what else has this race got in store?
Well, it could have plenty more, I think, the way it's been going. But Gary Paffett away from all the mayhem. And starting on his last lap now, Gary Paffett. But still, we've got this Reuter-Ekström battle. And Reuter spins Ekström around! Oh, dear! And damn it, look at that!
The Audi team very, very unhappy about all of that. You can understand why, because then starting the last lap, Ekström barged out of the way. Manuel Reuter went for the gap. Well, it's going to be a Mercedes win, Andrew Marriott, for Gary Paffett, but I think there's going to be quite a lot of discussion about all of this post-race.
No question of doubt about that. Well, the bonnetless Audi heads towards the finish point here. But Gary Paffett awaits the plaudits, the flags, the air horns, and takes his third victory of the year. And slows to a halt there by the mechanics. And the rest of them come through. Well, that was some race. Apt finishing second. And Reuter takes third place, David, at the moment, from Ekström and McNish.
Well, we've just had news, Andrew, that the stewards have had a look at the video evidence of that incident with Ekström. They've given Reuter a 30-second time penalty, and that's going to drop Reuter down to ninth position.
And Bert Schneider apparently getting a penalty also for not taking his drive-through penalty.
Gary Paffett there celebrating in style, getting a great reaction from all the fans. Whether they're Audi, Mercedes or Opel fans, they're all responding. And a superb drive that by Gary Paffett to win.
So Gary Paffett comes home with his third victory, puts him in very good stead indeed for the title. But we can hear now from Manuel Reuter about that incident.
Matthias
left the gap. He drove completely to the outside along the barrier, not along the racing line. And I didn't have a mirror left anymore. And when someone leaves the gap open, I'm going to drive into there. Then he came to the inside and I hit him. He spun around. I crossed the line as third and then got this 30-second penalty. That's how it is. And this is how the results are, David.
Gary Paffett the winner, Christian Abt second, and Matthias Ekström then on to the podium. Finishing in fourth place, Alan McNish, Martin Tomczyk fifth, Heinz Harald Frentzen recovering to sixth, ahead of Christensen, Kaffer, the demoted Reuter, and Bent Schneider in 10th. Alex Margaritas finishing 11th ahead of Laurent Aiello. But now let's hear from Matthias Ekström.
For me, it was a very exciting race.
at some stages because I got spun around two times and had some crashes as well. So I was surprised that the car standard so much contact, but I'm happy to be coming to the finish line.
Let's check out the points as Gary Paffett climbs onto the bonnet of his car. 44 points for Paffett. Ekstrom now on 41 and Christensen third on 28 points. Good drive from Christian Abt. We hear from him next. I noticed in the warm-up already that the car was running very well. We did absolutely everything right, I think. A big compliment to our team, especially in the safety car phases. We were in making perfect timing with the pit stops, which put me in the front. My start was also very good, says Christian Abt. And Gary Paffett sprays the champagne, the young man from just north of London. What a season he's having. So let's check in with him now.
Amazing. I mean, I got a good start, got in front of Tom on the start, and then there was a bit of confusion at the pits, the safety car with the first pit stop, and I nearly went into the pits and we nearly made a mistake. But they did an excellent job in the end to bring me in, you know, the one lap after the other with the pit stops. And at the end, there was, you know, no competition really. I was a long way in front and I was just, you know, keeping the keeping the car and the brakes and the engine cool and just cruising home. So the team really did the best job today.
And what's the verdict of the boss of Opel?
A lot of safety car laps, and in the end, we finished only on the sixth position because Manuel finished third, but he had a small fight with Ekström, and Ekström spun. So that means there was a penalty of 30 seconds, and Manuel is now on the ninth position. In the end, for Opel, it was good. We were really able to win the race, and that gives us a big motivation for the next races, which we have in front of us.
And the boss of Mercedes-Benz, Norbert Haug, must be very pleased with the job done by Gary Paffett. But what about all the other incidents? Let's hear from Norbert right now.
Gary did a fantastic job. We were slightly handicapped, or badly handicapped, I have to say, after the first safety car, when the safety car came out. But after the second one, when the safety car came the second time, we made two stops in a row. That was key for Gary's win, and he had the speed to push. He overtook after his second pit stop in one lap, three cars, and did a great job. Thanks to the team and thanks to Gary.
So Mercedes happy, but what then about Audi? Because of course on that last lap, its leading driver Matthias Ekstrom barged out of the way by Manuel Reuter. Let's hear next from Dr. Wolfgang Ulrich.
It was an incredible race. It was really stressing on the pit wall. It was maybe or quite sure very entertaining for the spectators, but there have been all things unpredictable as they can be unpredictable. Every strategy you had before the race you could forget every 5 minutes, and so it was just reacting on the chaos. At the end, the result, second and third, is really one we can be happy with. We also have three more cars in the points, so for the team it's a good result. Not so nice that Matthias lost his lead in the championship. On the other hand, we brought us in a good position in the brands, in the manufacturers' championship. Unfortunate race for Tom Christensen from the pole. For sure, he expected more, but that's racing.
Yes, that's racing, and the big crowd leaves the Norris Ring.
Hello, my name is Alan McNish. We've had a good race here, and so goodbye from Norris Ring. And I'll see you next time in the Nürburgring.
Yeah, thanks, Alan. Well, from me, David Addison and Andrew Merritt, we certainly enjoyed that big battle in this incredible street circuit. DTM heading now for the second part of the season. And we'll just say goodbye. See you again next time.